Yeah, thanks to everybody for the opportunity to talk about Apache Flink. And I can assure you, you will get something out of this talk. And we'll try to be also practical, so after this talk, you can go and play with Flink. So as the title says, maybe it might sound kind like odd for some people, right? The entire world is talking about Apache Spark, right? And somebody coming from nowhere saying, why Apache Flink is the 4G, 4G like for fourth generation, right, of big data analytics framework. So you see this logo for Apache Flink, that's the squirrel, right, with this cool tail. And that tail actually matches the color of the Apache Flink. It's a way of saying we are committed to the open source and the Apache Software Foundation. You see that also picture that I stole right from the Big Data Scala website, and the color match, right? So I like to put this together. And on your left, you see the logo of the company I work for, which is Capital One, which is a bank. And people think technology in a bank. Yes, actually, we are more like a software company, more than a traditional bank. So that's C1 for Capital One. So enough. Other thing that I would like to emphasize before starting this talk is that I used some of the materials, some of the slides from Data Artisans. Data Artisan is a startup company based in Berlin, Germany, and they are actually the people who are developing Apache Flink. Obviously, this is open source. There is many people contributing, not from Europe only, but from United States, from Asia as well, and not as committer only, but also as a contributor. I myself consider myself a contributor in a way that I'm evangelizing it, and I'm running two meetups, one in Chicago, the Apache Flink meetup, and another one in DC, and I would like to share something with you. Back in February 2012, I was giving a talk about transitioning from Apache MapReduce to Apache Spark. So I somehow also helped a lot evangelizing Spark, and this talk is popular. If somebody goes to slideshare.net and searches for Spark, obviously it's, I have two actually talks which are in the top five. So at that time I asked this simple question, did somebody ever heard about Apache Flink? They have an audience of over 200 people and only one or two showed their hand. Now things are changing, actually. 6 months later, actually, like in Chicago, we have over 300 almost users, and things are growing. So I will share with you why the interest of in Apache Flink. I have a large slide deck, so my style is a little bit different. What I'm noticing sometimes when you give a talk, and when you don't have the recording with the talk, sometimes it's going out of context. So what I'm trying to do, usually I give a very detailed slide deck, so people, even if they don't have the recording, they can go in their way. But during the talk, I won't obviously go in every single detail and every single slide. It won't, I can volunteer if you stay a couple more hours, right? So here we go. Let's start now, enough talking. So the agenda for today is what is Apache Flink stack and how it fits into the big data ecosystem. We will quickly explain this Apache Flink. The second major section about our talk is why Apache Flink is the 4G, fourth generation of big data analytics framework. So I picked this, talking about 4G, to do the parallel with the wireless networks, right? First generation, second, third, fourth generation, already there is the fifth generation. So I think, when it comes to big data analytics, we have a similar situation here. Will there be any fifth generation? Obviously there will, right? But for now, my assessment of the available big data analytics stacks is that Apache Spark is an excellent tool, doing great, but unfortunately, it cannot be a silver bullet for any use case, and I will show some concrete example. Again, Apache Flink will not be also a silver bullet, but it happened that it have many features that allows it to be helpful for many use cases. And if after this talk you like what you are seeing and you say, you know what, let me give it a try and get my hands dirty about Apache Flink, I will show practical steps of how to do that. I will show for every single section 1, 2, and 3, I show what is covered. So this way we have an overview of all the talk before even we go in any single of this section. So the first section, as we are talking about the Apache Flink stack, we will give a very quick overview of what is big data, batch, and stream processing, just to give a context, and also a conceptual model about big data analytics stack. Then when it comes to Flink, we talk a little bit about the execution engine, the API, domain-specific libraries, architecture, programming model, tools, and how Flink integrates with Apache Hadoop and other open source tools. Somebody, by seeing this list, he will see, well, this is kind of like another Apache Spark, right? By just seeing the list of what we are talking about, we will see how this is different, right? In the second section, right, we will talk about how the big data analytics engine evolved, right? And then something which I did, I think, and this may be unique, I'm not saying myself here, but at least to tell you, after assessing what's Apache Flink and going deep into the documentation, I extracted some principles which I think Flink is built on. Maybe they did not list all of them while they build building the tool, but it looks like they emerged now, and this will be helpful for you, for all of us, to understand how this tool is different. And obviously, I would share why this is an alternative to MapReduce, alternative to Spark, alternative to Storm. When we say alternative, this doesn't mean replacement. So let's make it clear now, right? So alternative, it's about option. This means I have more option, right? Think about it when it comes to cars, right? You can have Lexus, right? And you can have IBM. If we do the parallel with like this big data analytics framework, they are kind of luxury, right? Compared to the poor Hadoop MapReduce, right? So when it comes to airplanes, you have Airbus, you have Boeing, and you name it, right? And you have also other type of planes, depends if you have a short number of passenger, whatever, I will stop here. It's exactly the same. So let me explain it again and again. It's about alternatives, it's not about replacement, right? And then something that I will share, this will be the benchmarking results. I know this type of things, when you talk about benchmarks, it's kind of like, not everybody will agree about the results will they show, but I will share with you some of the things which are also more recent. Now, if you like this tool, I will share with you how to get started quickly, right? How to continue learning and about this tool, and I will share some of my takeaways, right? I already shared a couple, but I will share more, right? So it took us almost like 7 minutes to introduce this talk, right? But at least what I think about is now you have it all, right? You know what this talk is all about, right? You feel maybe at ease after the talk, you know, this guy have over 120 slides, right? I'm fine, right? I can go check on my own pace. I'm not interested in every piece. I might pick one of the sections. So that's all about it, right? So here, if you see that cartoon, right? So that's your arc for the big data flood in OWA. You will need a lot more storage space. So basically, if the picture is not very clear, right? So you see Noah with his arc, right? And line, big line of animals, right? You can see elephant, right? You see pig, whatever, right? And obviously what we are saying here, you have another one, which is this squirrel, right? With the school logo actually coming, right? I won't read it, but this is a definition. I think it's a unique one, right? Maybe you can propose it to Wikipedia as well, because I think it's more accurate than what we have in Wikipedia. I won't read any of the slides. I can assure you about that, right? So here, when it comes to batch processing, I will say something interesting, right? Some years ago, actually, in a talk, somebody either working with Amazon or know people at Amazon, right? He asked us this simple question, right? He said, when you go to Amazon and you do a transaction, you buy something, right? Or maybe now you sell something, right? At that time, it was more about buying, right? So do you think that they are processing your transaction instantly? Most of the audience, they say, yeah, we receive an email confirmation, right? That's instant gratification, our transaction was processed. So the answer from the speaker was no, they don't process anything. They just send you an email and say, okay, thank you for your purchase. And then what they do, on the back end, they will go and process this transaction as a batch. So that's batch, right? So the batch is this model of you store the data, then you process it. That's the model. So it's a process after store, right? So we don't need to go into theory, whatever, if you remember this example. But from the user perspective, it's still kind of real time, right? So he's happy. Why Amazon, they are doing that for many reasons, right? But they are finding that 10% of the transaction, right, might need to be, they might contact you again saying, you know what, either your credit card, the date is not there, or use another method of payment, whatever, right? So it's good like, to see that that almost like it's kind of like a blurry like frontier or limit between like real time and batch. In this case, from the user, he's happy, while from the backend processing, they're doing it in batch. Let me give you an example about stream processing, right? Very concrete example that happened to me as well, right? So many years ago, I was in a furniture store, right? And I was with my wife, obviously, with my kids, right? So we wanted to buy some furniture, right? Unfortunately, actually, we went over the limit of whatever, you know what, I will say it again, I was with my wife, not by myself. So what happened, actually? The guy from the store, we were about to leave, and he managed to bring a coffee for us, say, wait, we can handle that. We will contact the bank, right? He made my kids at ease, sharing with them some toys. And we waited. And he called the bank. And then after maybe 20 minutes, we got approved for a credit limit increase. And we are happy now. We ordered the furniture, and left. A couple of weeks later, we got it. What's the story about this one, right? So what's the story here is that we as a customer, right, we wanted to do that transaction, right? We were over the limit, and the traditional way, it's declined, right? So imagine a word, right? When, instead, like imagine, right? Maybe a song, some of the people will like it still, right? So imagine a word when you are doing this transaction, right? And things will happen seamlessly, right? You won't even, nobody, the merchant or you will figure out about it. And the bank will have some processing behind the scenes where they automatically increase your credit limit based on something which is kind of like, let's say, score model or something. A quick trip, and they approve your transaction, right? So here it's a win-win-win situation, right? The merchant is happy, the bank is happy, they don't lose money, the client is happy, right? So that's the difference between here again, batch processing and stream processing. So for me, stream processing is, or real time in this case, stream processing is about like what I am saying here, business time. This is very important, right? This is very important. You might get into debate of microseconds, milliseconds, whatever, latency, low latency, whatever you name it, but that's what I see real-time stream processing as business time. If somebody is interested, I'm sharing a couple links here. One of them is recent articles by the creator, two of the guys who are actually, we can say there are many creators of Apache Flink, actually. It's not like one-man show. But one happened to be the CEO, the other one CTO of the Data Artisan. A very quick, actually, or very short articles. And I like it because they talk about these type of things, about like now we are moving, or there is a movement towards this real-time stream processing. There is an interesting paper also about the requirement of real-time stream processing. This paper is dated back to 2005. When you read it, it's like you read it, and it's wrote yesterday. Really, try it, and you'll say, wow. So that's what's happening, and obviously this guy, very famous, Stonebreaker, and the article is dated back to 2005, right? And this will explain to you eight requirement about real-time stream processing. Now, what's a typical big data analytics stack, right? In the Hadoop world, right? We can give this very quick, like this conceptual model, right? When you have at the lower layer, right? The database or storage or streams, you have a resource management execution engine, and then you have libraries or APIs on top of it. That applies to Spark, that applies to Hadoop, that applies also to Flink. I will save you some time going for every single one, but obviously you already recognize what we are talking about here, right? So Flink, as we said, actually is a tool or big data analytics framework, which was born in TU. Like TU, this is for Germany. Anybody here with German roots? So no, yes, no? Yeah, anyway, so if we read this one, it's Technische Universität Berlin in Germany, And then other university also joined it. And what's interesting is since 2009 or late 2008, this project is there, almost at the same time of this of Apache Spark. By the way, there is a hidden relation between Spark and Flink. I won't say the names. One of the founders actually of Apache Spark is a student of a professor who is leading the streaming piece of Apache Flink. That makes it, that this means that these tools are really watching each other very closely, which is good actually for the big data community. So that's what we are saying here. Now I will we will stare together at this diagram. So this will save us a lot of slides. After we are done with this diagram, we will be good to go for the next section, right? About more about what's the feature or the characteristics which make Apache Flink so unique. Any question before we move, because we spent some time on this one? Any question, please? No, not yet? Okay. So hopefully, maybe after this one, you might have some questions, and maybe you can hold them at the end, so this way we can actually answer them. And also, this we can continue our discussion, right? Nothing prevents us from having questions. We can follow up by blog, personal email, Twitter, whatever you name it. Because sometimes, let's say it, it's not practical. We have a talk of 40 minutes, and you reserve 5 minutes for a question. Sometimes an answer to one question can take 10 minutes. Anyway, but that's the constraints. We can try to be creative. So if you see this diagram, please, and let's stare at it here, right? So here at the bottom, storage, right? So you see files, databases, streams. This Apache Flink tool, like Apache Spark, right, is agnostic when it comes to file system, right? So it's not tied to any file system. It takes it all, right? Files or database or streams. Same thing when it comes to deployment, right? Same thing. So this way, why I'm keep referring to Apache Spark, because I know most of the talks on this big data Scala are about Spark, which is really great. And it's good that we have a reference, right? Same here when it comes to deployment. You also have the tool, the Apache Flink, is agnostic when it comes to the deployment. I coined a couple of words. For example, when it comes to the storage, I say, bring your own storage, BIOS, right? We do the parallel, bring your own beverage, right? So here, the same thing. When it comes to the cluster, because basically, when it comes to deployment, are there big distributed, big data analytics frameworks? So it's more, and they run in a cluster, so bring your own cluster. So that's something interesting here. For example, with Apache Flink, you can work locally in a single JVM, especially for local testing. For a data scientist, this is great. He can work with small files, and then he can move to the cloud very quickly without changing a single line of code. How about that? This is true. When it comes, for example, to using Docker, you can do the same. You deploy to the Docker cloud. It's not a free advertisement for IBM. It happened to be one of the examples out there. So I started with this bottom layer, so to say that we are agnostic for when it comes to the file system, we are agnostic when it comes to the deployment. Now the main important thing, and this is where things now started changing compared to Apache Spark, right? The runtime here is not a batch. The runtime here is a stream processor. That seems odd, right? But it's the reverse. In Apache Spark, you have your core engine is a batch engine. And the Spark community came with a clever way of simulating the stream processing with micro batches, which is great for many use cases, right? But not 90% or 95%, as is claimed, sorry for that. Here, this is different, right? Here, the core engine is a streaming, and then batch is a special case of streaming. So think about it like streams like unbounded, right? Yeah, streams. And about batch is kind of like finite, right? So it's kind of like limited finite data set. That's something which is unique about this tool right away, right? So you see here you have two major abstraction. The data set, which is for the batch processing, the data stream, which is for streaming. Why you have two APIs here? Because you have two code paths, but they share a lot between themselves. But basically, you have windowing, for example, in streaming, which you don't need, or in batch. But what's important about this tool is something which is unique. As they are actually using idea from the MPP world, right? Massively parallel processing databases. You have an optimizer. For example, in Apache Spark, this is so far only confined to query, right? SQL type of query. No, and when it comes to Flink, this is everywhere. So that optimizer, so that's the idea coming from databases, right? You have your logical query and then your execution query. It's two different things, right? So this is very important. It's both for the batch processing and the stream processing. Now, if you take a look at the API libraries on top, right? Obviously, this is very similar, and let's say it, to kudos to the Apache Spark community for actually here it's this way. You can tell that Flink, they are following that way of having many workloads running on the same powerful engine, right? FlinkML, I'm sure you guys did a Flink machine learning, table for that for query, Jelly for graphs, and something really unique here about Apache Flink right away, right? So in that orange color, these are not the tools or libraries within the system, right? It's from outside, external, right? You see Hadoop MapReduce. So we don't have this in Apache Spark, for example. What happened with Apache Flink? You have a compatibility layer, a thin layer. When your existing code, your MapReduce code, you just run it. You don't need to change anything. You just run it, right? Now something even more more surprising, right? If you invested money and time in, let's say, building stream application, right? Real-time stream application using Storm, right? Now with this also compatibility layer, right? You can run this on this engine. So you have the power of this engine while you don't need to change your code. This is very interesting. Obviously, you don't have this in the Apache Spark world. And that's very, I think this is already a unique actually feature. You're already seeing some things. And like this one, right? I tried to analyze extensively this tool, and I came with some principle. So here, how you extract from this principle, right? That Apache Flink, one of the guidelines, right? They try to help you like a leverage, right? Or whatever investment you have done in another tool, they can allow you to continue. Same thing for cascading. At Capital One, we are a heavy user of cascading. And now, recently, right, it will be announced, let me tell you this, next week and the week after, that cascading runs on Flink. So for us, it's a switch of a configuration, basically. You have this on Spark 2, I think in cascading 3.1 or something. So that's idea here. It's great, right? So I'm not stuck with MapReduce, right? I can use another engine. I'm done with this one. I hopefully that gave you actually an idea where we are heading. I will not go in any single of these slides. The execution engine, we said it's true streaming capabilities, right? Everything is executed as a stream. Something unique about Apache Flink here is the native iterative execution. And here, somebody will tell me we do have iterative processing in Apache Flink. In Apache Spark, I will tell you, no, this is outside of the system. Here, what's different here? They have operation, right? They have operation, which is like map and reduce. They have iterate and delta iterate. What you gain from this, many of the machine learnings and the graph processing, they do use iterative type processing. And they, this is a secret weapon for Apache Flink. They are being, sped up what I will describe about the way, in a surprisingly way, really. And the number will follow, will show that. So that's something also, right? So this is all based on the execution engine. You have something which is unique also about, I won't say unique anymore now. I will give this as concrete example. So for Flink, they operate on managed memory. And this is the secret sauce, how they can get boost the performance. So it's like you are manipulating the memory like C++, right? Obviously, Apache Spark now is copying, let's say it's copying Apache Flink. There is no harm with that. But if you read the blog, I did that experiment. If you read the blog, which is announcing the project Tungsten, it reads like a copy-paste on most of the documentation of Apache Flink. And I take responsibility for that. You can check it out. There is no harm on that, right? So this is good. The Flink community, they are actually, when it comes to machine learning, they are saying it in their documentation. They are being inspired by the Spark MLlib. And here, the Spark community are inspired by the management of the memory. So this is really great for the benefit of the community. So that's the execution engine. Here, obviously, you have different workloads: real-time stream processing, machine learning, batch graph analytics. Right? The Flink APIs. You already touched on that. You have the batch and the stream. As you are guys, you are Scala guys, right? So here, maybe you can take a look at this slide: DataSet API, batch processing. So if you take a look at the code, right? So it's not much different, right? The top and the bottom one, right? The only difference here is in the windowing, so very similar, right? So that's kind of, and obviously you have a short and expressiveness. I won't stop here. I will stop here, and you can take a look at yourself. At least it's good to have a feel so how it looks like: flat map, group by, print, execute, like lazy actually execution. Very similar actually to Spark, to tell you the truth, when it comes to API. So that's what I notes, right? So here. So DataStream API, they worked originally on batch, and now the Flink streaming piece is in beta, and I think it will be out of beta after 0.10. Maybe I would share a secret. Yeah, after 0.10, it will be 1.0 actually, to show you how mature is this tool becoming, and it's crazy how things move it. If you check the code base 9 months ago, and now it's kind of like a different world. Yeah, here, DataStream API, so roadmap. So I will save you some time here. I won't go through everything in detail. What interesting about streaming, right? So they are working on the machine learning on top of streams, graph processing on top of streams, and I think this is unique. And also the integration with the Zeppelin. There is already an integration with the Zeppelin, we'll touch on that, but for the streaming is yet to be done, right? Relational query too, also this API is very expressive. I will save you time, right? Yeah, okay. Yeah, so that's what we said, actually. Flink architecture very common to, when it comes to the execution, right? When it comes to the execution, you have the model as usual, job manager and task manager, right? I won't go through details, but something here I want to touch upon very quickly, right? So Flink is implementing the Kappa architecture, right? So we have a great speaker here in this conference. Maybe it's better to ask from him right away, but it's not exactly what I will be saying here, but at least one aspect of it is you can run batch on a streaming system. So Flink is actually implementing that, right? There is a couple of references about the Kappa architecture here. Excellent, actually, article or blog from Jay Krebs and also from Martin Kleppmann. I will strongly advise you to take a look at this slide. Remember it. That's slide 30, right? There is an evolution or revolution going on. And it's good to see what's going on, actually, when it comes, actually, to this Kappa architecture versus the Lambda architecture and all the goodies. Yeah, I'm done with this section, right? And now I will move to the second section. So the second section is basically about, here I will say it in 30 seconds, similar to Spark, almost like Apache Flink integrates with everything in the Hadoop and ecosystem, right? And open source tools, so there is not much difference here. Maybe something interesting actually to notes here, that similar in the Apache Spark, you can play with different file system as well. Something also good to share that now I'm not doing any advertising for Google, but it's kind of like, it's good to listen or to watch what Google are doing. I mean, that's kind of my 2 cents. What Google are currently focusing on is in their Google Cloud Dataflow, which is a kind of like abstraction. So you have streaming and batch, unique API, right? And unfortunately for them, they have 2 engines, if I'm not mistaken. Now, what's good about Flink, that you can take whatever with this open API, whatever you build with the Google Dataflow, you can run it on Flink, and now you have a single engine. So so I'm done with this section. I took a little bit more than I expected, but here we will focus on this fourth generation thing, right? So obviously, if you take a look at this slide, you started with batch, and then Tez, although it doesn't have actually client facing API, but Tez, which is also used only by Hortonworks, is open the door for the interactive type of processing on top of Hadoop. And obviously, they were successful in making Pig and Hive run faster. Spark take it to another dimension, right? With near real-time stream processing and iterative processing. Now, why I'm seeing the Flink is the fourth generation, right? Because now you have real-time stream processing. So think about it, like first generation, no streaming at all. Second generation, right? You can have another tool, which originally wasn't built to run on Hadoop, that's Storm, right? But they managed to run it on Hadoop. Now Apache Spark came with this great idea of having streaming run on top of the batch engine. Flink, they are taking it even to another dimension. When you have, they reversed everything, you have a streaming engine and you run batch on it. So that's very unique. Also, that idea of having iteration, right, iterative processing within the system is very unique to Flink. And now you are seeing the cyclic data flows. It's not anymore just the direct acyclic graphs. No, now you have cycles, which is really unique. So that's actually, I tried to be short. I can explain in full details even more why it's a fourth generation under the hood. But think about this, actually, this slide, where it's make it very short, right? Now what I said actually, and I extracted like principle on which Flink is built, right? I think these slides are unique. I'm not sending myself again, but watch out. So the main vision, so they have this in their original documentation, right, and Apache Flink. So they get the best of both worlds. So you have the MPP database technology, massively parallel processing, right? You have the declarativity, the query optimization, the parallel in-memory and out-of-core type of algorithm, right? Now what you get from the Apache Hadoop MapReduce, massive scale-out, the complex data type, schema on read, and user-defined function. Now they merged these two words, right, and they added unique things. What are these unique things? The streaming, the iteration, the adventure data flow, as we saw, now you have cyclic data flows, and the general API, right? If you get these slides, what I mean if you get, actually, stare at it, take your time when you have the slides, this is the meat of all this talk, really. So that's how Flink is differentiating itself, right? Now, furthermore, right, I came with a few other principles. So the first slide was this is in the vision, in the Flink documentation, right? Now the second principle that Flink is based on, what I said here, this might not have been set up front, right? It's not like they came with a specification and they say, you know what, this is guideline 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, they came with a vision, right? And that was mainly this one. But as the tool is being built, right, what I observed, I can extract some principle, and I think this is how Apache Flink is differentiated, right? So unique to Flink, all streaming, all the time. So execute everything as streams, right? You write like a programming language, but you execute like a database. This is really beautiful, right? You alleviate the user from a lot of pain. I played with Spark, actually. I did some evangelism for free, right? And unfortunately, right, I was punished recently, right, when I published some benchmarks comparing Flink with Spark, right, my post on the LinkedIn user whatever group, yeah, was deleted. Maybe it was a warning, like in soccer, right? Now you're getting the yellow carton, right? Next one will be the red, right? So that's funny, right? So, but if somebody, you can do it now, actually, you are in front of your laptops. If you go to slideshare.net and you search for Spark, actually, a couple of my talks are in top 5, actually. I'm not saying myself, but unfortunately, sometimes there are things happening in the community, but anyway. So what I'm saying here, right? So main thing, actually, people are suffering, right? When it comes to memory, right? How many times you have an out of memory while you are running your Spark program? Don't lie to me. Can I see a show of hands? Only one. So you are super smart in what? In managing or configuring your memory, right? So which is good. So what's good about Flink is that it tries to alleviate you from doing that, right? Configuration is minimal, right? And it's doing that for you. So it's shielding you from dealing with the physical execution. When it comes to joins, broadcasting, reusing partition, whatever, you don't need to care about that. So that's major difference, right? So obviously in Flink, for example, if you download the Flink distribution on your laptop for running in a single machine, you just run it right away. You don't need to configure anything, right? It runs as default. And this idea and this spirit of minimizing the configuration continues even when running on the cluster. So I came from the Hadoop world, and in the previous life I was a system architect at Hortonworks. And I have to pay heavy price, actually, when I came with Spark Big Data, which is a website listing. It's kind of like knowledge base about Hadoop, Spark, and Flink, right? I will share this publicly, unfortunately. So I got even from the legal department an official email telling me, you know what, we are about to go API, and watch out, you are saying that Spark is the next generation, right? So that's kind of like how things are. Now I'm happy that in the company that I'm working on, Capital One, nobody is blaming me for saying, you know what, watch out, the Apache Flink is the next generation and I have my reason, right? Let me tell you something. If you go to the one of the slides, if you search for Spark, and you see that slides dated back to February 2015, I said that the last line of my talk, watch out, Apache Flink, it's getting mature and it will get more broader adoption when it comes to real-time stream processing and machine learnings and graphs when you really need a lot of iteration, right? So that's major, actually, I think, major differentiator, right? The slides are already there, actually, and easy. Now what I will see and publicly and the big data Scala will get a credit for it. 2016, I will say it loudly, will be the year of Apache Flink. So, and now in a few months, I will see if what I'm saying, what I'm claiming is right or wrong, right? So so here we said when it comes to tuning also, you have a little tuning. Support for many file system, nothing specific. Spark is doing that, agnostics, when it comes to file system and deployment. Both are good citizens of the Hadoop ecosystem, right? So they let you integrate. But what's unique about Flink, as I said it, preserve your investment, right? You name it, Hadoop MapReduce, a storm, cascading, you don't need to do anything, you just switch a configuration or run it as they are. Support for many use cases, this is no much different from Apache Spark. So now I want this detail here why Flink is an alternative to Hadoop MapReduce. Spark already did a great job of educating people about that. And maybe I listed here 10, I have in my drafts about 20. I won't actually go into the details here, right? I will prefer to go to talk about Storm, right, and Apache Spark. So when it comes to Storm, how many of you know that Twitter, who originally the backing Apache Storm, is using Storm? So the question, let me ask you this question very quickly, right, so we can save time. So do you know if Twitter is using Storm? Can you show with a show of hands? They are not, excellent. So you are saving me time. They are not, right? A big surprise, right? So in January 4th, right, they made it public, although for the last 2 years, they are not, actually. And they came with their Apache Huron, right? So they are listing 16 reasons, basically in plain English. They are saying why Storm sucks, right? So that's basically it, right? So they are not making it open source yet, right? So the question here, what are alternatives, right? If I have a true real-time stream processing, and they gave you an example with that clip, right? Credit line increase processing, or let's say other type of use case. I don't have much option, right? Besides commercial tools, right? So here, Apache Flink is raising as one good alternative to Storm, and I'm listening many reasons, right? Now, when it comes to Apache Spark. So true low latency streaming engine, so Spark micro batch aren't good enough. I'm not the only one who is saying it. I'm glad that Ted Danning will be giving here in San Francisco talk on August 27, and will be sharing many use cases and showing why micro batches are not enough. The second reason why Flink is an alternative to Spark. You have that iteration, right? And as I said it for the third time, and we'll stop, the Apache, the many machine learnings and many graph processing tools, they will have a lot of performance boost when they run on Flink. Custom memory manager, originally that was a kind of differentiator of Flink, but I think with what Apache Spark is doing, with the project Tungsten, and with time it won't be anymore a major differentiation. The other thing, automatic cost-based optimizer, this is still a major differentiator from Apache Flink. As I said it in the first slide, right? So they continuously or always do the cost-based optimizer, right? So you have the logical query, if you think in terms of query, and then you have your execution query. They do it not just for SQL queries, but for streams and for any type of workload. the little configuration required, little tuning. So let's go a little bit more details here. Somebody will say, and unfortunately, the Spark community are claiming in many blogs and slides, they say that 95% of streaming use case can be handled with microbatch. So my answer is really, so I'm coming from finance background, right? And now I'm currently working for a bank, right? We have a lot of use cases when you can do it in a batch. Financial fraud detection, financial store monitoring, anomaly detection. Outside of finance, you have traffic management, and healthcare, patient monitoring, online recommender when it comes to retail, and you name it, right? So so you really need, in many use cases, the true low latency type of streaming engine. Why iteration? I see a lot here of you, and I know a few of them, not a lot, who are machine learning experts, right? And I will say, if I'm saying this incorrectly, correct me. So machine learning algorithms such as clustering, K means canopy, gradient descent, logistic regression, matrix factorization, they all need iteration, right? So if you have something, iteration, which is running within the system, right, you will boost the performance. Same for graph processing. Page rank, line rank, you name it, right? So this is iteration operator is an operator. So there is something which will iterate. And there is something which is called a data alterate. If we have more time, we would have gone through that, right? So here, memory manager, as I said it a couple times, right? So Spark is catching up, and I said it already, right? Flink is going to the next level, or next, is currently working on providing an off-heap option, bypassing the heap altogether, and it's coming. I'm watching out very closely, and they have a pool. It's a matter of testing it, and they will have it soon. I'm sure Spark will follow. So that's about customer built-in optimizer. So what does it mean here, right? So example, if you have a join, right? So it figures out if it's a sort, merge join, or hybrid hash, or whatever, right? Imagine in the old days, like a pig, right? You need to figure out which data size is smaller than the other one to figure out if it's left or right join, whatever. So this tool takes care of that. When we so the benefit of cost-based optimizer is that you run you write your tool on your laptop, right? And then when it executed, it's automatically actually being adapted to the size of the cluster or the whatever environment. So that's about it. Yeah. So little configuration. I won't talk much about it. I will for the benefits of time. There is references here in the slides about benchmarking. And I know this is maybe sometimes, it's kind of a lot of debate around it. But let me tell you this, how this started, right? First benchmarking I ever saw, Flink against Spark, was a few professors at the university in Germany, Leipzig, and they came with it, right? And what and this was published on June 24th. And the proceedings of the International Conference of Business Information Systems. What's happening here, actually? They find out that when it comes to batch, Flink have best performance. When it comes, actually, the machine learning graph and relational, Flink has that performance. A few weeks later, right, a postdoc guy from Korea, right, what he found out, and with the help, let me share this with you, with help from the Flink community, he was able to boost the batch performance and showed it. The code is available that even in batch, Flink is beating not only MapReduce and Tez, but also Spark. And this is an open call to the Apache Spark community. The code is available. Let's have, for the benefits of the company, of the big data community, right? You can publish your results. I did reach out to, there is a few professors at the Academy of Science in China, and I did reach out to them. They already have a suite of benchmarking, actually tools, and they have MapReduce and Spark. They are planning to add Flink. And there are also some results comparing Storm with Flink. Now in the last section, and they will be finishing in 1 minute, so if you like what you saw, or at least you got interested in that, your first question, maybe you're still reluctant, and you'll wonder the question, who is using it in production, right? I asked my friend Google, and I managed to find out a few of them, right? The last find was yesterday night, Big Data Europe. I found out this is kind of government somehow agency, right? They are working with a lot of countries, and they are actually planning to use Flink. So this means it will have actually a bigger adoption, right? I have the details here in these slides of how to go in this 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 8. Verify requirement, download, unpack, check, start, validate, run. I can assure you in 10 minutes, in no time, you will be up and running with using Flink and with using also the REPL which comes with Flink. Less than 10 minutes. So we are all about to be done. Often the question comes, do you have interactive Scala shells? The answer is yes, and this is how it looks like from my own machine. This is a couple examples that you can run. The other good news that you can happen this cool tool, the Zeppelin notebook, and you can now play with Spark and Flink on the same notebook, which is beautiful, actually. What I mean, they both supported, right? Now, if you would like to learn more about Flink, obviously the flink.apache.org, but also watch out the blogs from the dataartisans.com. And this is a shameless plug. I maintain my own Flink, not Flink knowledge base, but let's call it big data knowledge base, when you can find information about Hadoop, Spark, and Flink. It's a sparkbigdata.com, but obviously if you type flinkbigdata.com, it's the same website, or hadoopbigdata.com, same website. Now, I shared it today, an Apache Flink crash course, which in 2 hours we were able actually to show Flink from local to cluster, to all the details, from running in an IDI, from tuning, whatever. The slides are available and the link is there. Also, there is a free training from the Data Artisan. Free training, the exercises, the setup, installation guides, and everything is free. I'm wondering how this company will make money, so everything is free. Yeah, sorry if they're hearing me. How to contribute to Apache Flink, code, test, documentation, whatever, right? And there is a contribution guide. The last thing before I close is there is an upcoming conference, Flink Forward. I managed to have a 25% discount for the Scala by the Bay attendees. And this is the code, take it note, because I will take this out from the slides later. So it's FF Scala by the Bay 25. So if somebody is interested, you can have, although it's not very expensive, but already you can save time. So what are some of the key takeaways? Although most of the current buzz is about Spark, Flink offers the only hybrid real-time streaming plus batch open source distributed data processing engine. So if you find another tool, yeah, let me know at sbaltagi@googlemail.com, and I will thank you for that. So I will foresee more maturity for Apache Flink and more adoption. I foresee Flink embedded in major Hadoop distribution and supported. Apache Spark and Apache Flink will both have their sweet spots despite their Me Too syndrome. And I showed you a couple of things about the Me Too syndrome, how they are copying each other, and keep watching yourself. Sorry, I went over time for 7 minutes, and your question, feel free to send them my way, and I will make sure to answer them.
We'll have
Thanks.
Time for a couple of questions.
Oh, yes. Yes, please.
So is the master fault tolerant? Is the state stored in memory, or is it stored off in?
The streaming?
For Flink.
Yeah, so for example, if major question is about the stream processing, and I will give a concrete example here. I have a lot of respects for Matai Zaharia, who is giving a keynote tomorrow, right? He was asked this question, how Flink and Spark are different, and he gave that differentiator that Spark, when it comes to fault tolerance, right, they are not supporting. You cannot actually blame him, he cannot be up to date for everything, right? I shared and I even contacted the KD Nuggets, where the interview happened, right? And I invited the Spark Flink community to give their say on that. Let me say in one word, right? Flink streaming, I'm focusing on Flink, not only have a fault tolerance, but also exact ones semantics, and also its light weight, actually, when it comes to the, when it comes actually to overhead of making sure that your application is fault tolerant. I hope I answered your question. So short answer, yes, it supports fault tolerance. And I was focusing on stream processing. Yes, please.
So my question is, are you...
Oh, sorry, let's
sure.
So yes, my question is Flink using a common execution engine as Tungsten is trying to achieve, or is using a different execution front end and back end for each language?
No, actually, it's the same. So let me tell you, when it comes to language, actually, originally, Apache Flink is written in Java. And also many of the, and also obviously they're using Akka under the hood, and they're using Spark. So they are good citizens when it comes to the Spark language. And recently, for example, the table API, which is for SQL query, is 100% pure Scala. The machine learning, 100% pure Scala. So it's the difference here, right? So it's in Java, right? And then you have also Scala. And when it comes to APIs, you have Scala yeah, everywhere. Yes, please. Sure.
Anyone? Thanks, Lynn.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, feel free to connect over Twitter or Google or whatever you your preferred way. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. I, you know what, Alexei? I forget my name.